Thank you, everybody. What an unbelievable crowd. Thank you, Fort Collins. Thank you so much, Fort Collins. Thank you, CSU. This is pretty around here. I should have gone to school here. Yeah. All right, now I know. What a spectacular campus, what a spectacular crowd, and a spectacular day. Thank you so much, everybody. There are a couple of special acknowledgments I want to make. First of all, my dear friend from the United States Senate, Ken Salazar. Give him a big round of applause. To the great governor of Colorado, Bill Ritter. And we have a special guest over from Wyoming side, Governor Freudenthal. Give Governor Freudenthal a big round of applause. We've got one of the finest members of Congress that we've got, who will soon be your United States Senator, Mark Udall, is here. A great friend of mine, former mayor of Denver, former secretary of transportation, one of our national campaign co-chairs, Federico Peña. Love you back. A great friend, an early supporter, Congressman Ed Perlmutter. Give him a big round of applause. And finally, a soon-to-be member of Congress, Betsy Markey. That's it. Now, before we get started, let me just ask, how many people have early voted? That's what I like to see. For those of you who did not raise your hand, okay, first of all, everybody who early voted, raise your hand again. Okay, now, just keep your hands up, keep your hands up. All right, now, if you have not early voted, then talk to that person who's raising their hand next to you and find out how to early vote. It's easy. It's fun. It'll do you a world. You'll feel morally superior having already cast your ballot while those lazy procrastinators are waiting until November 4th. And if you need to know how to do it, you can just go on our website, co.barackobama.com or www.voteforchange.com. There are all kinds of ways for you to figure out how to cast your ballot early. Avoid those long lines. Now, I especially want you to vote early if you're voting for me. If you're voting for the other guy, you should just wait until November 5th. I'm just teasing. It's actually November 4th is the election. Now, Colorado, in just 9 days, you'll have the chance to elect your next president. You'll have the chance to bring the change we need to Washington, and that's the good news. But we're going to have to work for it. We're going to have to struggle for it. We are going to have to fight for every single one of these next 9 days to move our country in a new direction. We can't let up, and I know we won't. Yes, we can. I know you're not gonna let up, because one of the things we know is that change never comes without a fight. You know, in the final days of campaigns, the say anything, do anything politics all too often takes over. And we've seen it before, and we're starting to see it now. Right? The ugly phone calls, the misleading mail and TV ads, the careless, outrageous comments, all aimed at keeping you from bringing about the change that we need, all aimed at keeping us from working together, making you cynical, making you frustrated. We've seen these strategies before. But you know what? I don't think it's going to work right now, because it's not what America needs right now. The American people don't want to hear politicians attack each other. You want to hear how we're going to attack the healthcare crisis and attack the energy crisis and attack failing schools and attack an economy that's not working for middle-class families. That's what the American people are looking for. So we need a new politics, and we need honest leadership, and that's why I'm running for President of the United States of America. Now, I think all of us understand that this is a moment of great uncertainty for America. Now, the crisis we face is the worst since the Great Depression. Businesses large and small are finding it impossible to get loans, which means they can't buy new equipment, they can't hire new workers, they can't even make payroll for the workers that they've got. We've lost more than 750,000 jobs just since the beginning of this year. And wages are lower than they've been in a decade, at a time when the cost of everything from health care to college has never been higher. It's getting harder and harder to make a mortgage or fill up your gas tank or just keep the electricity bill paid. At this rate, the question isn't, are you better off than you were 4 years ago? The question is, are you better off than you were 4 weeks ago? So, what we need is a real debate about how to fix the economy and how to help the middle class. But that's not what we're getting from the other side. A couple of weeks ago, my opponent's campaign said, if we keep on talking about the economy, we're going to lose. So, that's why I'm talking about the economy a lot. No, they said we don't want to turn the page on talking about the economy. We're going to be focusing on attacking Obama instead. And you know what? That's one campaign promise that they have actually kept. I mean, they have been throwing everything at me but the kitchen sink, hoping that something's going to stick. McCain even called me socialistic for suggesting that we should focus tax cuts not on wealthy corporations, not on millionaires and billionaires, but for ordinary Americans who are struggling, which I thought made sense. The other day, Senator McCain took it to a whole new level. He said that I was like George Bush. He said this. You can't make this stuff up. I was confused by this since I've been opposed to every one of Bush's economic policies. And yet, despite that well-documented record of opposition, Senator McCain said that I would somehow continue the Bush economic policies and that he, John McCain, would reverse them. Now, this is what he said a few days ago. Then, this morning, he's on the Meet the Press. And Senator McCain admits that he and President Bush share a common philosophy. That's what he said. A common philosophy. And I guess that was John McCain finally giving us a little of that straight talk he was talking about. It's been missing for a while, but he was being straight, because he was owning up to the fact that he and George Bush have a whole lot in common. We know that the Bush-McCain economy and economic philosophy, we know what it looks like. It's a philosophy that says we should give more and more to folks at the top, to millionaires and billionaires, to the wealthiest among us, and that somehow it's all going to trickle down on the rest of us. It's a philosophy that gives tax breaks to wealthy CEOs and to corporations that ship jobs overseas, while hundreds of thousands of jobs are disappearing here at home. It's a philosophy that justifies spending $10 billion a month in Iraq while the Iraqi government sits on a huge surplus and our economy is in crisis. for 8 years, we've seen this philosophy at work. And it's put our economy on the wrong track. And we can't afford another 4 years that look like the last eight. It is time for change for Washington, and that's why I'm running for President of the United States. And we know that the economic crisis hit Wall Street, but it's also been hurting Main Street for many years. You know, during the primary, Senator McCain was saying we'd made great progress economically under George Bush. Last month, he was still arguing that the fundamentals of our economy are strong. Well, let me tell you, there's nothing more fundamental where I come from than having a job. And when you're losing 750,000 jobs just this year, the economy is not strong and the fundamentals are off track, and we need to bring a fundamental change to Washington. We know that we have to get spending under control in Washington so that we're not mortgaging our children's future under a mountain of debt. The young people here, your future under a mountain of debt. But for all of Senator McCain's tough talk on spending, he voted for 4 out of 5 Bush budgets that let things get totally out of control. $500 billion deficit even before this financial rescue package. That's not change, supporting those kinds of ideas. We know that it's time for new ideas and new leadership in the White House, but Senator McCain voted with President Bush 90% of the time over the last 8 years. 92, somebody just corrected me. Just the other day, George Bush returned the favor and voted early for John McCain. Well, Colorado, George Bush isn't the only one who gets to vote early. You can vote early too, and finally put an end to the Bush-McCain philosophy. You can vote for a new direction. We know what's coming from the McCain campaign over the next 9 days. It's the same kind of politics we've seen the last 8 years. It's a politics that's more about tearing your opponent down than lifting this country up. Let me tell you, I can take 9 more days of John McCain's attacks. What the American people can't take is 4 more years of the same failed policies and the same failed politics. We're not going to let George Bush pass the torch to John McCain. I'm running for President of the United States of America because I solemnly believe that this country is better than the politics that you've had over the last 8 years. You deserve better. We need a government that reflects the core decency and generosity of the American people. Now, I know these are difficult times, Fort Collins. I know many of you are worried out there. But I believe we can steer ourselves out of this crisis because I believe in this country. I believe in you. I believe in the American people. We are the United States of America, a nation that's faced down war and oppression, great challenges and great threats. And at each and every moment, we have always risen to meet these challenges, not as Democrats, not as Republicans, but as Americans. With resolve and with confidence and with that fundamental belief that here in America, our destiny is not written for us, it is written by us. We choose our own destiny. That's who we are. That's the country we intend to be. But it's going to take a new direction. It's going to take new leadership. We're going to have to turn the page on 8 years of economic policies that put Wall Street before Main Street and ended up hurting both. One of the things that we have to understand that John McCain doesn't seem to understand is that when everybody's doing well, when the bus driver and the teacher and the firefighter and the sheet metal worker and the teacher and the I saw their t-shirts, so I thought I'd give them a shout out. When everybody's doing well, that's good not just for each of us, it's good for business, it's good for the wealthy. They've got customers that can actually afford to buy their products and their services. We need policies that grow our economy from the bottom up so that every American everywhere has the chance to get ahead. Not just the person who owns the factory, but the men and women on the factory floor. Not just the CEO, but the secretary and the janitor. Because if we've learned anything from this economic crisis, it's It's that we're all connected. We're all in this together. We're going to rise or fall as one nation, as one people. Now, the financial rescue plan that passed Congress, that was a necessary first step to easing this credit crisis, which is going to be spilling over to the rest of the economy. And we had to make sure that we didn't see more bank failures and the complete collapse of the financial market. But if we're going to rebuild this economy from the bottom up, really and truly rebuild this economy so the fundamentals are sound, we need an immediate rescue package for the middle class. That's what we need. And that's what I will do as President of the United States. I've proposed a new American jobs tax credit. Instead of giving jobs to companies that ship jobs overseas, we're going to give a tax credit for each new employee that companies hire right here in the United States of America, right here in Fort Collins, right here in the United States of America. We got to invest in companies that create good jobs right here. And I'll help small businesses, which create most of the jobs in this country, get back on their feet by eliminating capital gains taxes and giving them emergency loans to keep their doors open and hire new workers. And we'll create a jobs and growth fund to help states and local governments so they can save jobs and pay health care and education without having to raise your property taxes. And we also have to act quickly to help people stay in their homes. You know, I've been talking about this for months now, the problem with foreclosures. I want to help responsible homeowners refinance their mortgages on affordable terms. And we should put in place a 3-month moratorium on foreclosures to give folks the breathing room they need to get these renegotiations done, get people back on their feet. I won't let banks and lenders off the hook when it was their greed and irresponsibility that partially got us into this mess. We should not be bailing out just Wall Street. We should be restoring opportunity on Main Street. That's why I'm running for President of the United States. Now, these are steps that we have to take right now, short term, to start getting our economy back on track. But we also need a new set of priorities to grow our economy and create jobs over the long term. And it starts with tax relief. There's been a lot of talk about taxes in this campaign. And the truth is, you know, John McCain and I are both proposing tax cuts. The difference is who we want to give them to. John McCain wants to give an average of $700,000 a year in tax cuts to Fortune 500 CEOs. I don't think that's such a good idea. They don't need it. They're not even asking for it. I want to put a middle-class tax cut in the pockets of 95% of workers and their families. That's what I think makes sense. Under my plan, tax rates will actually be less than they were under Ronald Reagan. Less. And it is true, that I want to roll back the Bush tax cuts on the very wealthiest Americans and go back to the rate they paid under Bill Clinton. This is what John McCain calls socialism. What he forgets is that just a few years ago, he himself said that those Bush tax cuts were irresponsible. He said he couldn't, and I quote, in good conscience, unquote, support a tax cut where the benefits went to the wealthy at the expense of middle-class Americans who most need tax relief. That's what he said. Well, he was right then, and I'm right now. So, let me see a show of hands. This is a good sampling, a representative sampling. How many people here make less than $250,000 a year? Raise your hand. All right, that appears to be the majority of you. If you make less than $250,000 a year, which includes 98% of small business owners, and by the way, 99.9% of plumbers, then you won't see your taxes increase one single dime. Not your payroll tax, not your income tax, not your capital gains tax, No tax. That's my commitment to you. And look, keep in mind that for the last 8 years, we've tried it John McCain's way. We've tried it George Bush's way. We actually have an experiment in their economic theories over the last 8 years. They have been tested. They have been found wanting. They are not working for you. They're not working for this country. They're not working for this future. And that's why we need to put those ideas out of work. We've got to try something different. No more of this giving more and more to those with the most. And guess what? Part of our agenda has to not only be to make our tax code more balanced, but we've got to invest in the strategies that are going to grow our economy and create the engines of economic growth in the 21st century. And you know something about this here in Colorado. As president, I want to invest $15 billion a year in renewable sources of energy to create to create 5 million new green jobs over the next decade. Governor Ritter's doing it. The people of Colorado are doing it. Think about it. Jobs that pay well and can't be outsourced. Jobs building solar panels and wind turbines. Taking some of the farms out here and growing switchgrass for cellulosic ethanol. Creating new biofuels and creating fuel-efficient cars, not in Japan, not in South Korea, but right here in the United States of America. Jobs that will help us end our dependence on oil from Middle East dictators. Jobs that may just save our planet in the bargain. And I'll also put 2 million more Americans to work, rebuilding our crumbling roads and schools and bridges, laying broadband lines in rural communities so that companies can locate there and everybody has access to the internet, setting up a new electricity grid so renewable energy from wind and solar can get to the population centers that need it. We need to build an American infrastructure for the 21st century. And just remember, if people ask you, well, how are we going to pay for this? You tell them, if we can spend $10 billion a month rebuilding Iraq, we can spend some money rebuilding the United States of America, putting people back to work, solving our energy crisis. Yes, we can. Yes, we can. Si se puede. Yes, we can. Yes, we can. Yes, we can. Yes, we can. All right, so we need to deal with energy. That's part of the long-term solution. Here's another thing. As president, I'll finally fix the problems in our healthcare system that we've been talking about for decades now. Now, this issue is personal for me. My mother died of ovarian cancer at the age of 53. I'll never forget how she spent the final months of her life lying in a hospital bed fighting her insurance company because they said it was a pre-existing condition and they didn't want to pay for a treatment.
That's what I do.
You know, and let me tell you, as president, I will make sure that these insurance companies can't do that again. Yeah. You know, because John McCain has a different idea. Like George Bush, he wants to tax your health care benefits for the first time in history. Let insurance companies keep discriminating against people who need health care the most. It's the same failed insurance company first, your family last health care plan that we need to change. My health care plan is pretty straightforward. If you've already got health care, keep it. You don't have to change your plan, change your doctor. The only thing we're going to do is work with your employer to lower your premiums. If you don't have health care, you'll be able to buy into a plan just like the one that members of Congress, including John McCain, give themselves. And we'll invest in preventive care and new technology so that we can finally lower the cost of health care for families and businesses and the entire economy. That's the kind of change we need. All right, so we got energy. We got energy, we got health care. Number three, we're gonna give every child in America the skills and knowledge they need to compete with any workers anywhere in the world. I will not allow countries to outteach us today so they can outcompete us tomorrow. It is time to provide every American with a world-class education. And that means investing in early childhood education. It means recruiting an army of new teachers, paying them higher salaries, giving them more support in exchange for more accountability. It means making a deal with every young person in America when it comes to college. You know, my opponent's chief economic advisor was asked about college affordability. And he said, how come Senator McCain doesn't have a plan? And this advisor said, we don't think it makes sense to just give money away to every interest group. Interest group. I don't think that the young people of America are a special interest. I think they're our future. I think we've got to do better than that. And that's why to all the young people who are here and to all the young people all across America, I'm going to make a deal with you. If you are willing to commit yourself to service in the community, to your country, whether it's joining the military, joining the Peace Corps, working in a homeless shelter, working in a veteran's home, teaching in an underserved school, working in an underserved hospital, whatever it is, whatever way you decide to serve, if you are willing to serve, then we are going to make sure that you have the money to go to college, no ifs, ands, or buts. You invest in America, America will invest in you. Together, we're going to move this country forward. Now, here's the thing, Fort Collins. Here's the thing, Colorado. The change we need is not going to come easy. It's not going to come overnight. I mean, this administration has dug a deep hole for us. We've got a lot of debt, and we've got a lot of problems. And we're all going to need to tighten our belts, and we're all going to need to sacrifice. We're all going to need to pull our own weight. And, you know, I can put more money in education, but I can't be the parent who turns off the TV set and puts away the video games and makes sure that the child is doing their homework. That's the parent's job. We can put more money into energy efficiency, but everybody here, look at this unbelievable crowd, all of you have a responsibility to insulate your homes and turn off the lights when you leave the room and to check the gauge, to check the pressure on your tires. It seems like small stuff, but it adds up. See, the point is that one of the things that we're going to have to do post-election, regardless of who wins, is we've got to regain an ethic of responsibility, a sense of seriousness about the future and our obligations to each other, because now more than ever, we are all in this together. We don't have the luxury of relying on the same political nonsense, the same slash and burn tactics that are used every election to divide us, to make us afraid of one another. We can't afford it. With the challenges and crises we face right now, we can't be divided. Not by class, not by race, not by region, not by who we are or what policies we support. You know, contrary to what my opponents say, there are no real or fake parts of this country. We're not separated by the pro-America and anti-America parts of this country. We all love this country, no matter where we live, no matter where we're from. There are patriots who supported this war in Iraq and patriots who opposed it. Patriots who are Democrats and patriots who are Republicans. The men and women from Colorado and all across this country who served on our battlefields. Some may be Democrats, some may be Republicans, some are independent, but they fought together and they bled together. Some died together under the same proud flag. Look at this veteran right here. God bless you. They have not served a red America or a blue America. They've served the United States of America, and that's the country we need to be. We have always been at our best when we've had leadership that called on us to look past our differences, to come together. Leadership that rallied the country around a common purpose, a higher purpose. I'm running for president because that's what we need to be right now. This country and the dream it represents are being tested in a way we haven't seen in nearly a century. And future generations will judge us by how we respond to this test. Will they say this was a time when America lost its nerve, when it lost its purpose, when it lost its way? Are we going to allow politics to divide us once more? Plunge us into an even worse recession? Or is this going to be one of those moments where people look back 20 years from now and say, that was another one of those moments where America overcame, when we battled back, when we toughed it out, when we stood back up, when we recognized that common stake in each other's success? This is one of those moments. I know some of you are probably cynical and fed up with politics. I know a lot of the young people here, you're disappointed and even angry with your leaders, and you have every right to be. But despite all this, I ask of you what's been asked of the American people throughout our history, especially the young people who are here. I ask you to believe in yourselves. Believe in each other. Believe in the future we can build together. See, I don't think we can fail if we're together. Not when we have a crisis to solve and an economy to save. Not when there's so many Americans without jobs and without homes. Families who can't afford to see a doctor or send their child to college or even pay the bills at the end of the month. Not when there's a generation that's counting on us to give them the same opportunities that somebody gave us. You know, you look at this crowd out here, and in this crowd, you think about how each of us got here. Somewhere in our pasts, there's a parent or a grandparent who said, you know, I may never be able to go to college, but if I work hard, maybe my child or grandchild will go to college. Somewhere in this crowd, there's a story of a parent or a grandparent who wasn't born in this country, but they said, you know what, I may not have liberty and opportunity, but I'm going to travel to America, the land of liberty and opportunity, so my child and my grandchild can succeed. Somewhere in this crowd, there might be somebody whose parent or grandparent or great-grandparent didn't have the right to vote, but they said to themselves, if we march, if we organize, if we believe, then maybe our child or our grandchild or our great-grandchild, maybe they can run for the United States Senate. Maybe they can run for the presidency of the United States of America. That's what this election's about. That's what we're fighting for, to make sure that the American promise is there for the next generation. And Colorado, if you will stand with me, if you are going to go out there and talk to your friends and talk to your neighbors and knock on doors and make phone calls, if you are ready to once again believe in the promise of this country, then I guarantee you we will not just win this election, but you and I together, we're going to change the country and change the world. God bless you, everybody. God bless the United States of America.